Welcome back to another series of podcasts about the brand new Eric Hutchinson album, Sing Along with Eric Hutchinson. I am with Eric. My name is James Campion. And let's start with the very first song. And man, you come out swinging here. It's called Everybody's Got a Beating Heart. And let's talk about, you know, the big giant elephant in the room, which is the hoo, ha, hoo, ha, ha. Now, that is fantastic. I think you're kind of saying you're simulating a beating heart. But only if your heart's beating like that, you might have arrhythmia. But I love it on many levels. I'm going to tell you why I do. But tell me, that's the perfect way to start this thing. In that way itself, again, it's not English. It's not Spanish. It's not anything. It's sounds. Right. It's getting back to the crux of where music came from. It's at our core, at our DNA. Is that why how you wanted to start this record?
I guess this, I wasn't planning on the song being the first song, so I didn't necessarily think of that, but yes, in terms of it's very guttural sounding. And I think when I was first writing the songs, I haven't thought about this really, but when I was first writing the songs, a big note I had to myself was sing-along songs have things that you can sing along even if you don't know the words yet, you know? So it's like, what are the things that get people to join in right away? You can learn ooh, ah, pretty fast. And it was a little bit of a beating heart thing, a beating heart. And also, who knows, when I first wrote it, I might not have, I thought it was just a placeholder. But then, yeah, I really liked it. I liked that it was this group thing that we could all do that was a sound, you know? So, yeah, it is a striking way to start it.
Everybody's wishing they could heal it. Everybody tries to play the part. Everybody has a human spirit. All right. Everybody's got a beating heart.
My first lineage, and there's going to be a lot of them in here. And I always make you laugh because when we did the Maxwell with the Maxwell Silver Hammer or something like that for one of your records, I'm sorry, this is that goomt, goom. Everybody's talking about it. Give peace a chance.
Totally.
One of the most amazing sing-alongs recorded in a hotel room with a bunch of people banging on
that
things.
That song was definitely on the inspiration playlist. So good work.
Thank you. It's what I call the marching beat,
right,
which always works for sing-alongs. And but this one, more than that, that's a true everybody get in a giant room and chant for peace. This is the first hint, too, that there's going to be soul, gospel, old folk styles here.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just straightforward gang vocal singing here. It's not even what, not to bring up Hey Jude again, but the na-na-na-na. It's not just that. It's a structured song that echoes into these other kinds of music. So even though I immediately thought of Give Peace a Chance, you pulled it in another direction. The song has more soul. To me, it has more soul structure.
Everybody wants a fighting chance. Everybody wants a turn to show up. Everybody's looking to advance. Everybody's got the right to grow.
Yeah, and I'll name check some of the people that I really was listening to. Big Bill Brunzi, Elizabeth Cotton, Sister Rosetta Tharpe, and just a ton of Southern American black, they didn't call them singer and songwriters. They were folk artists, but they were singer-songwriters who were writing songs about real life, and that was a lot of the music I was wanting to make.
Let's talk about the singers taking a verse here each way. This is a good way. We talked about it in the last podcast. A good way to start. It's not just about you. It's about everybody. And everybody's getting a shot at singing here. And then, of course, in a way, it represents your audience. It would have been a situation where you could have had people singing this back to you in an audience. And this way, the listener is kind of filling in what the grand chorale that this record is going to be.
Even when we all don't seem the same, even when we all act oh so strange, feel the blood pumping, pumping in your veins. Everybody, everybody, everybody's got a beating heart.
And so I guess the first question I should ask you is, how did you decide who would take each verse? Did you allow the singers to kind of look at it and say, hey, I like this, I got something for this? Did they sing the parts? So you go, oh yeah, that's good? Or did this just happen organically?
I just pointed and people sang. No, that would be even too organic for me.
That's crazy.
No, I said, why don't you take this first verse? Why don't you take the second? I had sort of an idea where we could go with it.
So you knew the singers and you knew when you wrote it, or you knew when it was done, these are the singers, so they would sing these parts?
Not when I wrote it, I was envisioning, okay, other people can sing this as well, and that will help keep the song moving. But I didn't know exactly who was going to be on it yet. Melanie Niema, my friend, she was always a person I was like, this, she has to be involved with this to make it work. But yeah, I think a week or two before we went in, I said, why don't you take the first verse? Why don't you do the second verse? And everybody just crushed it and really did some cool stuff with it. Now to the point where I'm trying to like learn how they sang it to try to recreate it when I sing it live, you know?
So if you do, this must be a tough thing to do, but will you do a show with all these musicians singing this?
I would love to. I would love to try to make it happen at some point, so we'll see.
I love the turnaround of, all right, everybody's got a beating heart.
All right, everybody's got a beating heart.
This is very, very reminiscent of a lot of songs in the grand scheme of soul music, especially All Right. But of course, I was thinking of Okay, It's All Right With Me, an earlier song of yours that has a similar feel to this song. It's got a soul background and it's kind of a sing-along thing. I wonder if you ever name check yourself or theme check yourself and say to yourself, ooh, this reminds me of something I've done, but let me go in this direction.
Certainly if I feel like it's something I have done, I try to go a different way with it, which is one of the challenges of having a bigger and bigger catalog when I sit down to write, is not only can I not, you know, I've got to figure out something I haven't done before. Lyrically, I would say the song is very different than Okay, It's All Right With Me. Okay, It's All Right With Me is about myself. It's about my 20-something self trying to calm myself down. This song is about having a universal empathy for anybody and everybody, and reminding everyone that it's another way of saying everybody is human. And
everybody has red blood, that kind of thing.
Yeah, and everybody is worth considering. And so that's, lyrically, the song felt very different. But yes, there is the word, you know, I say all right, and...
But it's the way it's used. You know, there is a certain style, and that's kind of the angle I told you before we started this, and I'm going to take a different angle with some of these questions. Usually we're very literate, and we go through each line, and we parse it and see where it came from. To me, I think this is a complete package of song, melody, style, and message. The message is all swirled up into how you're presenting it. And to me, the all right, you know, that kind of thing has been done from Ray Charles to Aretha Franklin to Kiss to whatever. I mean, everybody's used that terminology to get you there. And that's the kind of thing, these are the touchstones when I hear songs that bring me there, even if there is no technical lineage to that.
Right.
So, and I know there's no way you could think of that when you're writing about it. And I sometimes say these things to you and you're like, oh yeah, maybe I wasn't thinking about it, maybe I was. But ultimately, this song, for instance, the that's a substitute for a drum beat. Like a hip hop, do something over that.
Yeah, right. It's the kind of thing you would sing to a drummer and he'd be like, fine, I'll play that.
Yeah. That's a good point.
Yeah, but this song all these songs, I spent a lot of time thinking exactly lyrically what they were going to be saying. And this song is talking about that everybody deserves a chance and everybody deserves, has the right to grow up. And, you know, that stuff is strictly talking about police shootings and things. It's everybody has the right to grow up and live in our life and our society the same way. So it was, you know, there's maybe some subtext to it, but very much here when I'm singing all this, I'm saying this, everybody has a beating heart. And even when you don't understand somebody else, how can we bridge that to unify everybody.
Even when we all don't seem the same, even when we all act all so strange, feel the blood of moving, pumping in your veins. Everybody, everybody, everybody's got a beating heart.
And it's a specific line. It's not a metaphor. I mean, everyone does have a beating heart. If you're going to be in this world, your heart beats. It's
and that I mean, and that was something I thought about because I tried to think of a phrase. What is something I could say about everybody? What is something that unifies us all? And there's certain things people don't have. I mean, you know, not everybody has two arms.
Right.
Or not everybody likes ice cream, even though that's insane. So, you know, that's one of the few things that really fully unites us all that is, I can say without a doubt, is true for any living person. I'm sure someone will write into us and tell us, oh, my uncle doesn't have a beating heart. He's got a pacemaker, and he walks around with it on the outside.
And it goes, woo, ha.
Yeah.
All right, let's talk about the singers here. Caleb is a great way to start this. You go the male voice, but a male voice that is not Eric.
Everybody's wishing they could heal it. Everybody tries to play the part.
There's two, both your male singers here evoke Ray Charles, kind of a soulful feel. Great way to start. Then Melanie comes in.
Everybody's looking to advance.
I love the fact that she takes it again into a more gospel soul-y sound here.
Yeah.
She messes with the melody and she phrases it a certain way. And then you come in with the oohs.
Even when we all act all so strange, feel the blood of moving, bumping in your veins.
Which again is my first, uh-oh, he's going for the gospel. And I thought of the Soul Stirrers, and we talked about this today at lunch. Sam Cooke, the way Sam Cooke went from the very deep religious, to the point where they wouldn't let him change,
yeah,
to a magnificent secular popular artist who did what you do, right? Wrote his own songs, arranged them, produced them, put them out, got the bands together. I can't not listen to a lot of these songs, specifically this one, and not think of the great Sam Cooke.
Well, this song does remind me of him too, because he's got a
Yeah. Working
that's
on the
sound
thing.
Of
yeah,
the man. And so there is certainly that. I love Sam
Cooke.
Very
good.
And I was, you know, I spent a lot of time in 2020 thinking about all, I mean, I have done it in the past. I have the song The Basement that is talking about all of the black musicians that I really love and the soul music that has inspired me. But I've just spent a lot of time thinking about all the music that I'm indebted to. And Sam Cooke is absolutely one of them. I could point to 10 of my songs and point out stuff that he has influenced the way I approach something or saying something. Ray Charles is another one. And yeah, I think I went into this music being as wide-eyed as possible about that I was making what has traditionally been black music, and how do I do that in a respectful way. So that was one of the things that was definitely on my mind while I was writing and singing these songs.
And when I talk about Sam Cooke, Eric makes a good point, and that is, you know, when he was with the Soul Stirrers, which were a gospel group, and he became a big star coming out of that, and he was well known for sort of the crossover, you know, more tampered down version of like You Send Me and those kind of songs. But if you listen to, say, we've talked about this before, his Miami Harlem Club recording from 1963, you see where you get Rod Stewart. You see where you get a lot of the soul singers or even rock singers from the 60s and 70s. He's inventing a new style of singing.
Yeah, and he was part of the original class that was inducted into the Hall of Fame. It was Sam Cooke, Elvis. Who else was in there?
I would think Ray Charles now.
Ray Charles, probably. But I know Sam Cooke was in. I mean, Sam Cooke was the beginning of
Chuck Berry, maybe?
Pop music. Chuck Berry, maybe.
Buddy Holly, maybe those guys.
Should have been. Little Richard.
Sure.
We'll have to look it up.
Yes, or even Etta James. I know Etta James was inducted at some point, too. That's where Veronica, and I have Fromer Stewart, so there you go.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with that. She really does evoke Etta James here. She goes for it.
Everybody has a sense of freedom. Uh-huh. Everybody wants to feel alive. Uh-huh. Everybody wants to have the same rights. Uh-huh. Everybody's trying to touch the sky. All right. Everybody's got a beating heart.
Yes, absolutely. And she came to the project last and was recommended to me. And I didn't know her before we started doing this. And I was blown away by her vocals. She's young. She's finishing college.
Yeah.
And was able to get off 2 days from school to come do this. And
she looks like a bundle of happy energy, too.
Yeah, and she was super excited. And I'd seen her on a different video with Clyde Lawrence, and she looked so happy in that. And I was like, who is this person? She looks happy. She sings great. Sounds like she's right for the project. And yeah, she came out and sang. And Etta James, definitely she reminded me of. And also Lauryn Hill is another person that her voice really reminds me of.
Yes, so. And also they do a great job with clapping and the clapping matters. It's part of the ensemble, and it's not later on clapping. It's clapping while they're singing.
Yeah, and I think, to me, that was what it started off with, this idea that the first things we have to make music with are our hands and our voices. So, and I actually, I've learned this. People have kind of been joking around with me about this. Apparently, I put a lot of claps in my music in general. They're like, it's not an Eric Hutchinson song. It doesn't have claps in it. But I love claps, and again, I think they are so human.
I got a fever for more claps.
More claps.
It is very human, and I was wondering, I put this down here, and you mentioned it before, there wasn't a lot of ad-libbing going on. I mean, I'm sure if someone sang something, and was there a time when you were playing, and then you got caught up in the performance, and went, whoa, and then forgot what you were doing for a second, because you were blown away?
I tried very hard not to do that, but yes, at the end of this song, I do. You hear me at the very end of it, I say, I was feeling it too much. I forgot. I missed the last cue to end the song that Ian gave us, and I almost missed it, but we nailed it anyway. Yeah, I tried to try. It was a very mixed thing to try to really appreciate and get to listen to all these great musicians that I had assembled, but also keep my wits about me. And all of them were working extra hard to make sure, nobody wanted to be the person to mess up the take. So so everybody was trying really hard to nail it.
Because you were singing along with Eric Hutchinson somewhere along the line. You see what I did there? Let's get to there's not a lot of soloing and musicianship besides the wonderful accompaniment. There's a lot of, rightfully so, the emphasis is on the vocals. But in this song in particular, you have a quick trumpet solo from Wayne Tucker, and it's just so of the times. It just, it takes me right there to what it would be like when, let's get the trumpet player up on the mic.
And he was like, I know I'm here to sing, but can I play a little trumpet? And I was like, yeah.
Give him a bone.
Yeah.
But it works here.
I love it. And that kind of came together in the room, that whole vamp at the end. Ian, Allison and Clyde and Wayne really figured that out. And I love that it's a vamp section, kind of just breaks down, and the piano comes in at that point, and it's funky. And I mean, honestly, probably should have let it go on for longer, but I was, I'm always paranoid. I'm a brevity fan, but I love hearing that part of the song as it sort of goes into this sort of extra section.
Yeah, and I write down here the piano, very Dr. John meets Fats Domino, a little New Orleans feel to it, bringing me right back. And again, I utilize these touchstones for me because that's where I live. Mm-hmm. Things are constantly popping to my head. Oh, that's so great because these people, Fats Domino, Dr. John, Pine Top Perkins, Johnny Johnson, these guys invented a style that's irrepressible. It's just, you can't put the toothpaste back in the tube. And so when someone else is evoking that, I just see their ghost over their shoulder, just smiling. That's what I see when I saw him playing that piano part.
Totally.
It was
great. And he, anytime people can, a lot of people can do this, but I'm always still amazed by it when you can put your hand on two separate keyboards and play them together like it's one piano. He'd be playing his left hand on the piano and his right hand on the electric keyboard. And
it's crazy.
Like, I never get over. I'm just like, you got to be so good. And Clyde was really, really good.
And singing too. And coming back and nailing the moment where he has to get it going on. The line that jumps out to me And this had to be on your mind, is Everybody's Blowing in the Wind.
Everybody's waiting for a friend. Uh-huh. Everybody wants a sense of purpose. Uh-huh. Everybody's blowing in the wind. Uh-huh. Everybody's wishing they were perfect. Hold on.
Blowing in the Wind, of course, bringing to mind Dylan's 1963 masterpiece that inspired Sam Cooke's A Change Is Gonna Come, two of the most important songs to come out of the civil rights movement. And now that I know this is what on your mind, and you reference civil rights later on in the record, in fact, you can make the argument that Blowing in the Wind is the finest secular gospel song penned by a white man. And to me, that is really the underpinnings of this. This is you as a white artist who owes a great debt to black music, not only black music of we're going back to the 30s, 40s, and 50s, mm-hmm. and 60s here, real original American music, but also the music of Michael Jackson and Prince and those.
I was raised on that stuff in the 80s. But yes, I'm glad you caught my Blowing in the Wind. It was a little, it was a little hat tip. It was a lyric that kind of fell out there, and I felt like it worked. But also, I like it. I like the idea that we're blowing in the wind, we're out there. We're all trying to figure it out.
Yeah, and I think this, again, is a song of empathy. You're saying, seeing how the other half lives and then understanding it more about what you're going through. And I've often said this, and I'll make it quick. When I went to Israel in 1996 during the very first elections, which is amazing that Netanyahu was elected then. Then he had that short spate where he wasn't there, and he's still there.
Reel it in, Campion.
But the idea of the Palestinians and the Israelis living in the same small area that you could fit inside like a state in the United States. And when you talk to the people, not the politicians, not the movement, not the PLO, not the IDF, you see what they want. They want their kids to go to school safely. They want to be able to, they don't want to worry about the guy with the gun. They don't want to worry about the guy that has this religious belief. They just want to be able to get food for their kids, hang out with their kids, watch a soccer match. That's what they're all about. That's what the song seems to me. It's like, we all got to share this space. And you living in New York City, you see that all the time. This has been the great melting pot of America. Mm-hmm. And this song starts us off beautifully because everybody does, in fact. Even that guy with the pacemaker have a beating heart.
And to me, it was also, even if you're super liberal or super conservative or whatever it is, there's someone who you don't agree with. And to me, this song is also about that. Of even that person that you don't agree with, who's on the complete other side of it, they also have a beating heart. And what can we do to try to understand where they're coming from and what kind of common ground can we find?
And this song captures it perfectly. And a great opening track to, the sing-along concept. And it immediately became one of my favorite songs of yours, period. Everybody's got a beating heart. Eric Hutchinson, his first song from Sing Along with Eric Hutchinson. I'm James, that's Eric. Let's go on to the next track, shall we?
We shall.
Everybody's got a beating heart.